Madison Vinnick, and welcome to another episode of Movies to Watch on a Rainy Afternoon. Today's feature we're going to be taking a look at is a low-budget 1995 slasher film entitled Jacko. At least, that's what I think the movie is called. This movie is so inept that it doesn't even know its own fucking title. What am I about to watch here? Jacko? Jack-o'-lantern? Doesn't really matter. Either way, it's probably going to be a piece of shit. The movie starts off with John Wayne Gacy out in the middle of the woods, sitting around a campfire, telling a young boy the legend of Mr. Jack the Pumpkin Man.
Trick or treat, Sean. Mr. Jack will break your back, cut off your head with a whack, whack, whack.
Jacko is the story of a scythe-wielding pumpkin-headed demon brought back from hell on Halloween night, who stalks and murders helpless victims while on the prowl for the only ancestor left in his bloodline that can send him back to hell. And unfortunately for us, that ancestor is Sean Kelly, who's played by the director's talentless hack of a son. Seriously? This is our protagonist? I really don't want to spend the rest of the movie with this little bastard. We randomly cut to Sean waking up in his bed in the middle of the night. Am I supposed to assume that the previous campfire scene was all just a dream? We really don't get a solid answer because no more than a few minutes later does Sean wake up from a second dream sequence, followed by the opening credits. What the fuck? We follow Sean and a couple of his friends home from school when they suddenly meet up with a neighbor whom is branded a witch.
This is what they used to do to witches. They threw rocks at them, tied them up, and burned them. Bobby, don't!
Whoa, whoa, that was a close one.
I'll get her this time. Bobby, don't! You'll get us in trouble! Ow!
Sean befriends the accused neighborhood witch after foiling his buddy's delinquent antics from further continuing.
Bobby! Ah! Get off of him!
You okay?
Yeah.
Thanks for saving my car.
Sean is accompanied back to his house, where he introduces his new friend Vivian to his father preparing a haunted garage for Halloween night, and his obscenely wide-eyed mother. Seriously, she looks like this throughout the entire movie, always in a constant state of shock or surprise. We cut to yet another dream sequence, and this time John Carradine randomly makes a cameo appearance, despite having been dead 7 fucking years prior to the film's release, which means they wrote Jacko knowing they had stock footage of John Carradine lying around. That's not how you make a fucking movie! Sean is woken up after his little narcoleptic episode and provides the audience with some outstanding acting skills.
I had a scary dream.
All dreams try to tell us things. Even bad ones. Right now, your father tells me your favorite television show is on. Would you like to go watch?
I guess so.
Bravo, kid! Stellar performance! Sean's parents have got a ton of work to do in preparation for their haunted garage, including setting up a peephole show for their guests, which allows them to see disgustingly realistic body parts.
What's all the stuff for, Mom?
Supplies for the spook house. I've got corn syrup and food coloring for blood, cauliflower for brains, and
grapes.
Grapes. Yes, grapes. Because, as we all know, grapes are so aesthetically and texturally similar to human eyeballs that nobody will be the wiser. I know I'd be happy paying $2 to roam around some weirdo's garage for an hour and stare at a bowl of fucking grapes. Which begs another question. What little kid walks around on Halloween night with a pocket full of cash? This is the most flawed charity event ever.
Calm down, lady. Grapes aren't that fucking frightening.
Sean's parents, for some reason, come to the conclusion that they need a babysitter for Sean for the night while they attend to the charitable spook show, despite the fact that they're only going to be in the fucking garage.
Your father and I have to watch the garage, Sean, and collect the money. I know you're getting too big for a babysitter, but it's just somebody to keep you company.
Why do you have to collect money? We've got money.
But some people don't, sweetheart. The neighbors will give us money for the spook house, and then we'll give it to the homeless shelter. It's important to help people who haven't been blessed like us.
Yeah, you dick. At this point in the movie, we are introduced to the previously proposed babysitter, played by B-movie scream queen, Linnea Quigley. And just how is her character introduced? Why, stark raving nude in the shower, of course.
Stay classy, Jacko!
Who wears that much jewelry in the shower? Sean has another dream sequence regarding the original burial of Jacko, and John Carradine's stock footage is again recycled. At one point, he almost looks directly in the camera, as if to say,
I'm not in this movie.
Whenever he speaks, the camera is never on a shot of him, but behind the stand-in they hired for the movie. And then it cuts back to a close-up when he's done talking. You can't fool me, movie. I know what you're doing.
I am the judge of the hill. Not everyone is lucky enough to get my special attention.
Whatever. This sequence is intercut between three teens who have decided to take it upon themselves to party inside of the cemetery Jacko had been buried in, and subsequently resurrect the pumpkin-headed demon himself, who apparently has only been subdued for hundreds of years by a rubber flame-shooting cross. Jacko finally makes his appearance, 32 minutes into this fucking movie, and his first order of business? He attacks a case of Ham Special Light. Aw, what a weak-ass gore effect. That blood is painted on his face.
Better, closer, warmer. That's it.
Sean wakes up from yet another dream sequence. And another.
That makes 5 fucking dream sequences so far in the first 35 minutes of this movie. Where's Tom Hardy when you need him? Leonardo DiCaprio, this kid ain't.
The babysitter shows up with her sister and sister's boyfriend 6 hours early and reveals a little more information to Sean's father than we needed to know.
Yard looks great.
Well, I try.
You're like a little boy about all the scary stuff.
I guess it keeps me young.
I like little boys.
What the hell kind of dialogue is that? There is little to no doubt in my mind that this woman is a pedophile.
You like bikes, kid?
You ever seen a grown man naked?
Vivian, the woman from earlier who Sean heroically saved from a handful of pebbles, shows up with a book featuring a picture of John Carradine, explaining he was a great ancestor of hers. And a wizard! Of course he was.
Who's he?
Just some creepy-looking old guy. Why?
I saw him in my dream.
His name was Walter Mackin.
You must have seen his picture somewhere before. Isn't that right, Vivian?
When your son is dreaming of random old dead men, you should probably show a little more concern. Might as well just sweep this under the rug, right next to the pedophile babysitter and John Wayne Gacy accompanying campfire. This is the worst dad ever. Well, I guess his real dad is the worst dad ever, for making his son star in fucking Jacko.
We then cut to a random snobby Halloween-hating yuppie couple. Trick-or-treaters are rejected at their door and forced away.
Trick-or-treat.
You looking for a handout?
Yes, sir. We'd like some candy.
You want some candy? Does this look like a candy store? I make my living selling food. You want something from me, you pay for it. Got it? Good. Now get out of here.
This has to be the first time in movie history that anybody ever asked for money in exchange of Halloween candy.
Hey, I got an idea. No treats. It's time for a trick.
Well, that was efficient. You really showed him.
What was that sound?
That's it.
Wait a minute. Where did they get all that extra toilet paper? In the scene right before this one, it showed they only had 2 rolls on them. Where did all this extra TP come from? Carolyn, the babysitter, shows back up with her sister to look after little Sean. This time, far too dressed up for a babysitting gig. Is that proper babysitting attire? A shoulder-padded suit?
She's babysitting a 10-year-old! Why is she dressed up? Oh yeah, she wants to fuck him!
More pranks are bestowed upon the yuppie couple as their hubcap is removed and tossed at a nearby tree. The husband goes outside to check out what's going on when Jacko dispatches him and we're treated to some pretty cheap gore effects.
A little bit for trick-or-treating, aren't you, fucko?
Actually, it's Jacko.
Get out of my yard or I'll cut your belly open.
The wife discovers her husband has been killed, so she goes the obvious route of running back into the house while screaming and opting to leave the front door wide open. Realizing she needs to protect herself, she grabs the nearest knife available.
Problem is, it's a fucking butter knife. Not that she'll get to use it, though, because after she grabs the knife and manages to trip on a randomly placed floor mat, this happens.
That works too.
That was actually a pretty cool death scene. God damn it. I actually have something positive to say about this film.
We cut back to the Kellys and check in to see how their haunted garage is coming along. One child discovers the Jacko glory hole and takes off running.
Feels fake.
Does Jacko really have nothing better to do than terrorize children in a haunted garage? Go fucking kill some more people! Thank you!
Yeah, you take off. I'll stay here and bleed on these tires for a while. Sean's father goes looking for his son after hearing about a string of murders taking place around the neighborhood when he bumps into none other than John Wayne Gacy.
I'm trying to find Sean. Have you seen him?
He was here with Carolyn early this evening. I scared the hell out of them.
They say where they were going?
Halloween, David. I figured they're out looking for candy.
Thanks.
Trick or treat!
Jacko finally meets up with Sean in the middle of a park and attacks him. No build-up, no suspense. He's just fucking there. Jacko's intentions are eventually revealed, and in true horror cliche fashion, he's out to kill all the first sons of the Kelly family. But don't worry. Vivian totally has a foolproof plan. She's been willingly using little Sean as bait to draw Jacko out so she can kill him.
I'm hunting this demon. A family prophecy says that only the fifth male descendant after Arthur Kelly can destroy this creature. That would be your son, Sean.
Got any other sons we should know about, you stupid wide-eyed bitch? But as we'll find out, that plan is completely flawed because, well, I don't know about you, but I have absolutely no faith in this kid. Like, at all.
Yeah! Aw, fuck you, movie!
Jacko takes Sean back to the cemetery and forces him into a freshly dug grave.
Please, no! No!
Emote, you fucker! That was actually pretty entertaining. Let's watch that again. I'm going to hell.
Vivian shows up for what we assume is going to be a big duel between her and Jacko, but she's quickly disposed of. Or her dummy is. Whatever. I really don't give a fuck anymore. The payoff of Jacko's death isn't even at the hands of our supposed hero.
Come get me, pumpkin man!
The idiot somehow trips and impales himself on a piece of wood, which is apparently all it takes for him to explode into a shitty CGI fireball.
Really? That's it? That's the big climactic ending? Bullshit! Well, wanna hear the last line of the film?
I'd like a big slice of pie with a scoop of vanilla ice cream on the side.
What kind of pie, Carolyn?
Anything but pumpkin.
Yeah, fuck you too, Jacko.
If it had been made properly with a bigger budget and better talent, Jacko could have been a worthy entry in the pantheon of slasher films, and a new iconic face of fear would have been bestowed on horror fans alike. But as it sits, Jacko is just another shitty, forgettable, low-budget 90s slasher film with occasional TNA and some cheap-looking gore effects. The only redeemable factor about the DVD is the optional director's commentary between the director himself, Steve Latshaw, and producer Fred Olen Ray. Towards the end of the film, producer Fred Olen Ray makes a reference to a poor review written about the movie, and the director is not at all appreciative.
Who the hell else but me, Steve, would be putting this back out? I mean, it's been called a shit pickle,
in some reviews. It's been, I mean, who else but me? I mean, and at Halloween and with all these extras, I mean, it's hard for it's hard to sit here and say, excuse me a minute. How the movie turns out.
We discussed this commentary before we ever got into this, and you specifically stated you would not make any reference to the shit pickle comment.
I never heard that before.
Okay, I know, and you laughed your ass off.
I know.
You told me you were laughing when you said shit pickle.
I know, but
as a matter of fact, you said shit pickle more than once. You said that's so funny. Shit pickle, shit pickle. Well, you know what's funny to me?
You're making me laugh.
I'll tell you what, you can sit here and do this fucking commentary yourself.
Oh, come on, Steve. Jesus Christ. You know, Joe Bob. Jesus Christ.
I'm going to have to go ahead and agree with the shit pickle remark. In fact, that's how I'm going to rate this film. 4 shit pickles out of 4. Fuck this movie. And one last thing I'd like to point out before being officially finished with this shit pickle of a film, pinched from the ass cheeks of Steve Latshaw, is the official disc artwork on the DVD. Prominently featured nude on the disc is Rebecca Wicks, who plays Sean Kelly's mother in the film. Nowhere in the movie does a nude scene featuring Miss Wicks occur. Why this image appears on the DVD disc art is beyond me. But really, who the fuck would want to sit through that?